are very fortunate to have you, sir, with us for the second session. And I think most of the participants are already knowing you through your MOOCs and online MDPs. So once again, I put my hearty welcome you for this session. And I just invite you for this session. Now, over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. So good afternoon to all the participants. So today, whatever, maybe all of some of you are familiar with that the talk I want to deliver, but maybe it will be different perspective I want to present it. So my motto is accreditation and outcome-based learning, how it will be implemented in the classroom. I'm not talking about that, how accreditation can be done, how outcome can be written, not like that. I'm talking about the how it can be implemented in the classroom. So that will be the my presentation, main objective of the presentation. Now I go to the slide sharing mode so that you can see it. Is it visible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It is perfectly visible.
Okay. So now, challenge in 21st century education. As a teacher, you might be heard about that, or you might be faced some challenges in 21st century education, that how to improve student engagement. Most of the time we complain that the students are not engaged. They are not coming in my class. They are not listening. Many of us taking a class of 100 students, we found that most of the students doing Facebook, sitting in the classroom. Now, if you, this problem is not that for the students only. If you ask the students that why you are not listening in the class, why you are not attending the class, the reply from the students we maximum receive is that, sir, can you give me two reasons why should I attend the class? Because when I attend the class, I found that the teacher is presenting a material which is already available in the Google. When I attend the class, I found the teacher either reading the slides, I can read the slides, even myself also. So if the teacher is only delivering the content, then students said our engagement becomes zero. Then if you ask them, why you have not read that material in the hostels or in the house before you come to the class, then their answer is very simple. Sir, before I attend the class, I do not know what content teacher will cover. So that's why we have not read. And once I attend the class, I found that content is available in the Google and it will be sufficient to read it before 7 days before the exam. So what students basically think, okay, whatever the teacher is taking, that can be prepared 7 days before the exam. So if you see, most of the students will study 7 day or 8 day or 1 month before the exam, even if in general education also. If it is engineering education, you know that we have 8 semesters. So if the student studied 7 day before the semesters, then how much day is required to complete the BTEC degree? So maybe in 8 semesters, 7 into 8, 56 days is sufficient. Let's talk about 80 days is sufficient. Why should there be a 4-year degree program then? If 80 days is sufficient for clearing the exam and earn the degree, so why they should be engaged the 4 years? So as a teacher, we have failed to improve the student engagement. So as a teacher, 21st century teacher, I have to think, how do I engage the students throughout the semester? Not only that, oh, before the exam, they will be engaged. So what should I do as a teacher to engage the student throughout the semester? In case of general degree program, go for physics honors or the English honors, or even in graduate, any honors graduate course, how many days they are studying? Oh, sir, can you give your note? So they just prepare the note before the exam. Maybe if it is 1 year basis exam, 1 month before the exam. So why you require 3 year honors program? So 1 month, 1 month, 1 month, 3 months is sufficient for 3 years. So as a teacher, our motivation is that I have to engage the student throughout the semester or throughout the year, depending on the examination pattern or education pattern. The next challenge is how to equip students with 21st century knowledge, skill, and attitude. Today, this knowledge is not wisdom. Knowledge means information. Many students said, okay, have you know what is the binary tree? Have you know what is Maxwell equation? But if you ask them, yes, this is the problem, can you solve it using Maxwell equation? They said, no, so. So only knowledge in 21st century education is not sufficient for that teachers. So only when you go to the class, deliver the information or derive a second order equation in one corner of the board to next corner of the board, nobody is care about it. So you have to develop the skill of the students. What skill you have to develop? How they will apply the acquired information in a new situation. So as a teacher, I have not only to teach the info or deliver the information, I have to develop the skill on the students. If you see, there is a these slides. If you see these slides, this slide has two parts. First part is that students are carrying the information. Most of us have a kid in the home. What you do? Your kid goes to the school and miss said that this is the question, this is the answer, this is the question, this is the answer, this is the question, this is the answer. And students just remembering the entire answer and questions and deliver in the exam. After the exam, they forgot everything. All the parents are exhaustively seated in the outside of the school. Oh, last day, last night I have told you this question is very important. You have not read it. So what we are doing? We are actually putting information on the student's head. I will not say the student is intelligent if he remembers the capital name of 100 country. I do not require that. What is required? That I have the education should carry us, not we should carry the education. If you remember the Tagore, Tagore has already said it long back when he created the Vishwabharati, that we are not creating education system where a lot of information a student has to remember. We are creating education system where we can apply whatever we have learned. Or we can say that we convert the education to change the society. So education should carry us. So as a teacher, 21st century teachers, it is not sufficient to deliver information in the class. I have to equip student with skill and attitude. How do you develop the skill and attitude of the students? How to allow continuous improvement in the curriculum? Because every university said, okay, we have a curriculum revision committee. After every 5 years, they sit together a design and curriculum. Think about what is curriculum. It is nothing but a list of topics. But any course, take about the any course, whether it is literature, whether it is science, whether it is physics, whether it is engineering, courses are continuously changing. Today, which are important, tomorrow that technology is obsolete. So after every 5 years, every 10 years, improvement of the curricula is not important. It is a continuous improvement of the curricula is important. Most of the time, industry said that the syllabus which is covered by the university is outdated. So industry said they are not producing industry-ready engineer. What do you mean by industry-ready engineer? That means the education curricula or education system, the curricula is not sync with the industry requirement. So how can I develop a continuous improvement curriculum mechanism so that it is completely sync with industry requirement? Unless it is sync, then who will employ? What will do after that the students is passed out from the colleges? They should employ. They should open a company, entrepreneur, whatever it is. What is required? Not information. Required is the skill. So the desired skill, which is required by the industry, which is required by the current society, has to be incorporated in the curricula, and curricula has to be changed continuously. Not that after every 10 year or 5 year, there will be a curriculum revision committee and they will change the curriculum. That is not required. Then how to ensure examination system reinforced teaching and learning? I just take it 2 minutes, I just switch on the AC. So, examination system, most of our knows that examination system is there. If I ask you, why we take the examination of the students? What is the purpose for examination? I will elaborately explain it when I talk about the assessment and evaluation tomorrow. But today I want to think about it, all the participants, can you think on it? Why the examination system is there? What is the primary role of the examination system? Primary role of the examination is not to provide marks to the students. It is secondary. That is called evaluation. So examination is designed to reinforce the teaching and learning. So how should I design the examination system, or let us call assessment system, so that it will reinforce the teaching and learning? Not that, okay, I'll take the exam and oh, you got 80 marks, you got 70 marks, you got 50 marks. It is useless. Whole assessment is designed to reinforce the teaching and learning. So this point I will elaborately discuss during tomorrow's lecture. Next, how to ensure lifelong learning? Today, if you spoon feed the students, that if the education is not spoon feeding, the problem which you solve in the class and exam, you ask the same problem, then it is called spoon feeding. What is the requirement? I require to develop the self-learning ability of the students. So how do you develop the self-learning ability of the students? Students should have acquired an ability so that they can learn by themselves. Because teacher will be not there in all the time. After the 4-year degree program, they will pass out, join in an industry. So what they require? They require a capability of self-learning, self-learning ability. So how do you develop the lifelong learning ability among the students? Then how to teach a large class? I think all of maybe some of you take a class size is 200 or 100, 120 or 300 student class. So if it's a large class, what is the biggest problem in the large class? And what is the teacher-student ratio, best teacher-student ratio for taking the class? Can anyone in the chat box can write what is the teacher-student ratio for best teaching? Can you write in the chat box? What will be the teacher-student ratio for best teaching? One is to 20. Somebody write 1:25. Can you justify your answer? Why 1:20 is the best teacher-student ratio for learning? One is to 30. So this is a vague idea. Can you explain it objectively that for this is the reason, that's why that 1:20 is the best teacher student ratio? I think most all of you, maybe many of you are known about the learning theory. I think so. So what learning theory says, the best teaching happen when the instructor delivery is matches with learner learning style and learning approaches. Every learner has its own learning style and learning approaches. Learning theory says that best teaching happens when the instructor delivery is matches with learner learning style and learning approaches. Now every learner has its own learning style and learning approaches. That is also a function of time, function of emotion of the learner, function of the topic, function of the subtopic, all other factors. So I cannot say that this student is a visual learner, this student is a textual learner, that will vary with time to time. And that variation can be very abrupt. So if I obey the learning theory, then for the best teaching, the teacher-student ratio will be 1:1. That is called private tuition, private tutor. So if it is 1:1, then the best teaching will be happen, because the delivery of the instructor will depend on the student requirement, student that time. So the instructor can predict what is the student learning style and learning approaches. Based on that, he can deliver his information to the students. So it is only possible when it is 1:1. But it is not possible in practically. I have a 150 student class. I have a 200 students class. So what would I do to teach a 200 student class? So what is our objective? Our objective is that, can I use the pedagogical method, ICT technology, to virtually create 1:1 ratio in a large class? So what is the role of the technology? Role of the technology is to virtually create 1:1 ratio in a large classroom. So whatever ICT, education for technology, e-learning, whatever pedagogy I should use, main purpose is to create 1:1 ratio in a large classroom virtually. So that is called personalized teaching. All of you may be heard about personalized teaching, flipped teaching, you can say blended learning, all those things. What is the purpose? Purpose is very simple. To create 1:1 teacher student scenario virtually in a large classroom. Apparently, what is the problem you are facing in a large classroom scenario? As a teacher, you may say, if my classroom size is very huge, then if I teach for the first bench, the middle bench says, okay, that teacher is okay, but it is tough side. And last bench said, oh, it is very difficult, no, it is above the head, so you do not follow the teaching. If you're teaching for the middle bench, then the first bench said the course is very easy, and last bench still said it is very difficult, you should not follow the lecture. If you teach for the last bench, then the first bench and middle bench said it is useless teaching. So what should I do so that I can create a virtual scenario of 1:1 in a large classroom? If I able to create it, then the problem which I described, that if I teach for the first bench, that will eliminate. So this is the basic requirement in a 21st century education. Those are the questions which require to be answered. How do I improve the student engagement? How do I equip student with skill and attitude, not only the knowledge? How do I continuously improve my curricula? How do I make the assessment system such that it is reinforced teaching and learning? How do I ensure lifelong learning, ability development of the student? And how do I teach a large classroom? Or how can I create virtually 1:1 teacher-student ratio? So those are the questions. I, as a teacher, I have to find out the solution of these questions. So at the end of the lecture, I should able to give you the solution of question number 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. This examination system I will explain tomorrow lecture, assessment and evaluation. Okay? So up to this, it is clear. Now I go to the next part. already stuck. Just a minute. Okay. Now I come to the next topic, is called accreditation. So I made the question, I raised the question about the 21st century teacher requirement. Now I come to the accreditation, that all of you heard about that accreditation. Actually, what do you mean by accreditation? Why this accreditation is required? What is the genesis of this accreditation? The genesis of the accreditation is come from the requirement of the society. If I ask you why this education system was evolved in the society, from the primitive age, if I think how this education system was evolved, that if you think a society required different kind of skill labor. Somebody will make cloth, somebody will make medicine, somebody will make metal. So what is required? A skill labor in the society. To produce the skill labor, we require a system. And that system is nothing but an education system. So basic purpose of the education system is to produce a skill labor. Now, if it is that so, then suppose I am saying I am a B.Tech electronics engineer. Why society will accept me as a B.Tech electronics engineer? I have only a piece of paper where it is said that I am certified as a B.Tech electronics engineer. Who cares about the paper? So what is required? That if I say I am a B.Tech electronics engineer, then I should acquire certain skill which doesn't acquire by the general people. So society accept me as a B.Tech electronics engineer if I have acquired certain skill which is specific to B.Tech electronics engineer. Then only society can accept me as a B.Tech electronics engineer. Think about the civil engineer. I'm a B.Tech civil engineer. What society knows, if it is a civil engineer, that means he's supposed to acquire those skills. And that's why he declared as a civil engineer. So this is the first genesis for evolving of accreditation. Second genesis, cross-country movement. Suppose I say that I am a B.Tech electronics engineer from IIT. Why it will be accepted by USA? What are the criteria for acceptation of the USA? Why a country B will accept an engineer of coming from country C? Then they said, okay, to evolve, to solve this problem, they sit together and define minimum required criteria to become a B.Tech career, B.Tech engineer or higher degree. So that is called Washington Accords. There is a Abbott, lot of accreditation records are there. Main motto is that to define the minimum skill set which must a person acquire to declare him as a engineer or as a certain skill, certain degree. Then what is the requirement? What is the problem is came? The problem came that, okay, a B.Tech engineering from IIT doesn't require any accreditation at USA. Why? Because even education program produce a final graduate or output, suppose 4-year degree program produce a graduate output, the quality of the output can be measured by two methods. First method is called objective measurement. Second method is called subjective measurement. Example, when you go to the market to buy a computer or buy a television set, either from your home you can predefine, or you can, when you buy a product in Amazon, what you look for? Review. Out of 10 people, 9 says that this product is 4 out of 5. That means subjectively many people says the product is good. That's why the product is good. That is called subjective measurement criteria. So if I say this pen is good because many people say this company pen is good, so subjective measurement. IIT graduates are good because our alumni is already established. That perception of the people that those products are good, like Sony TV. Sony has already established its brand name, that so that many people say Sony is good. So that is called subjective measurement. Then subjective measurement can vary. Today some brand can be very good. Maybe after 30 years that brand can finish. That's the Philips. Earlier Philips was a very good brand. Now the Philips is not there. So that means that if I measure it subjectively, then I can say this can be biased or this can change. So what they want? They want objective measurement of the product. Similarly, objective measurement of educational program. All the degree, whatever you're giving, is called program. So for every program, if I want to measure the quality objectively, then what is required? Suppose I want to measure the quality of this pen objectively. So I have to define certain parameter, length of the pen, color of the pen, thickness of the pen, how it smoothly writes, all of the parameter to find out the quality of this pen. So if I want to measure a educational program, then also I have to set certain parameter by which respect I can measure the quality of the program. Those are called attribute of accreditation. Attribute of accreditation or PO, program outcome. At the end of the program, those are the parameter I should look for. So how they define? I just explained Washington Records, that NBA is same as Washington Records. So what they said in NBA, they said if a person said that I have completed a program after my 10 plus 2 years study for 4-year program, then that person must be or must acquire those 1 to 12 skill set. What are the skill set? Knowledge of engineering science. It is not knowledge. Don't see that this is said the student should know, describe it, define it, not that. What they said? They said solution of a complex engineering problem. Again, I am saying, I think you have already knows the Bloom's taxonomy of learning. So if you know the taxonomy of learning, then you know the all the theory classes are on cognitive domain, cognitive skill development. So in cognitive skill development, how many subdomains are there? Knowledge means remembering, comprehension, application, then analysis, synthesis, evaluation. So what they define, they said, a engineer after 10 plus 2, 4 years, 4 year or more than 4 year post secondary study. Means after 10 plus 2, 4 year program or more than 4 year program like your M.Tech program. They must have the skill. What is the skill? Solution of a complex engineering problem. That is the cognitive ability of the students. A student must have a cognitive ability to solve a complex engineering problem. So if you see, there are two dimensions. One is called cognitive ability, which is called solving ability, which is called application level of the cognition, and complex engineering problem. Why they define complex engineering problem? Because they said the complexity of the problem will vary from different college institute to institute. That means, suppose I say I'm an IIT BTech at computer science, or I'm an IIT BTech on another college B. Now suppose forget about the IIT, let's college A has a computer science program and college B also has a computer science program. But college A said that my program, I want to produce a high-end researcher who will take care about the high-end research. And college B said, no, I am not taking the risk, I am not producing researcher. I am producing a professional who will work in the local industry. So suppose the course in algorithm and data structure. So the complexity of the course, algorithm in data structure in Institute A computer science program and Institute B computer science program will be different. Because the requirement is different. If I'm producing high-end researcher, then my complexity will be much, much more high. And if I'm producing the industry-ready engineer, they may not require that much of complex problem. So that's why they said the two dimensions, solution of a complex engineering problem. Complexity of the problem can vary from college to college. But the skill, you cannot say, I am a private engineering college and my students are very weak, so they only know how to describe and define. No, they also have to solve the problem. But the problem may be very simple, not very complex. But the ability is solution ability. So when you write a course outcome, student will be able to define and describe this thing. The graduate attribute says that those things are essential but not sufficient for a graduate engineer. Next attribute, they said, the student should be able to analyze the problem. So the cognitive ability is analyzed. Again, complex engineering problem. Complexity may vary from institute to institute, but ability is analyzed. So your outcome must be in analyze level, but complexity may less. Then design and development. Student must able to design solution for a complex engineering problem and design system component or a part of a component or a process or part of a process to meet the specific need with appropriate consideration of public health, safety, cultural, societal and environmental consideration. So a BTech engineer, suppose you are teaching a course on electrical machine, and a BTech engineer, you said, oh, my college only know, they only know describe AC machine. No, they should able to design AC machine. Complexity of the AC machine will be less, but the ability of the cognition is design. Then investigation. Conduct investigation of a complex problem, including design of experiment, analysis and interpretation of data, synthesis of information to provide valid conclusion. So, what we are doing most of the engineering colleges, I'm not complaining, but most of people are doing like the same thing. There is an experimental setup, students will go to the experiment, don't touch the instrument, only take the reading. What student will do? Student will take the reading and go to the hostel. They will see the last year project report, last year lab report, just copy the last year lab report and submit it. So that's why if you visited any engineering college and you ask for the last 5 year lab report, all lab reports are same. But what they require, they have to know how to design an experiment. They have to know how to analyze and interpret the data, how to collect the data, how to synthesize the information to provide a valid conclusion. Suppose I'm, since my background is electronics, I give an example, very simple example. Suppose I'm doing a VI characteristics curve, voltage and current characteristics curve of a transistor. Now student take the reading, and this year they found that curve is not coming as per the book. Curve is coming slightly different. What student will do? They will just change the data and draw the curve as per the requirement. But math is not required. They have a wrong curve, but they have to be able to explain that might be these data points are not valid. So they have to be able to explain why their curve is not matching with book curve. And I can remember that we are doing an experiment for draw the hysteresis curve. So in forward direction, we collect the data, his curve is coming very nice. But when you collect the reverse direction data, the curve is just almost follow the same line of the forward curve. So we are not getting the perfect hysteresis curve. So what we have done? We have just manipulated data and plot the curve and submit to the teacher. But teacher said A plus. What is the requirement? I should be able to explain why that my retrace curve also follow the same line in the tracing curve. That is the correct teaching. So student must able to investigate. But what is investigation they require? Their skill is design of experiment, analysis and interpretation of data, write a valid conclusion. All those are important skills. Then modern tool and uses. Every discipline, there is a lot of modern tool, modern software. They have to use those software. You cannot say that you do not, a civil engineer said, I do not know CAD-CAM software. Then can I say that he is a civil engineer? A student said, sir, I have studied the VLSI course. And he or she does not know how to write a single line VHDL code. Can I say he or she is a VLSI design engineer? So every discipline has a lot of their tool. So student must acquire the skill how to use that tool to simulate something and what is the limitation of the tool. So 1 to 5, what is the ability? Solving ability, application level of the taxonomy. Analysis ability, analysis level of the taxonomy. Design ability, synthesis level of the taxonomy. Investigation ability, evaluation and synthesis level of the taxonomy. Modern tool uses, synthesis level of the taxonomy. So when you write your course outcome, they should also match with this ability, cognitive level, application level, analysis level, synthesis level, evaluation level. So if you say your course outcome, they should be able to define Maxwell equation, then your course is not required for BTEC engineer. 10 plus 2 or more BTEC or MTEC engineer. So this 1 to 5 is called domain dependent skill. If you see, the accreditation never said the knowledge, it said skill. Knowledge is essential but not sufficient. So 1 to 5 is called domain dependent skill. If it is civil engineer, they only know the modern tools on the civil engineering. If it is electronics engineer, they know that modern tools in electronic engineering. They know design in electronics engineering. Civil engineer know design only civil engineering. So that's why 1 to 5 are called domain dependent PO. a domain dependent attribute, domain dependent graduate attribute. Next, domain independent attribute across the domain, whether he is a civil engineer, electronics engineer, chemical engineer, doesn't matter, but everybody has to acquire individual and teamwork, the skill as a work as an individual and work in a team. Communication skill, it is not that they should able to write a poem like Shakespeare. They should communicate like a British English, not that. The communicate effectively. What effective communication? Because an engineer might have to communicate his co-worker, might have to communicate to the society, might have to communicate to the client. So they should able to effective communication. They should acquire the effective communication skill and writing effective technical report. Not they should able to write a poem like Chetan Bhagat, not required. Communication skill only required to communicate effectively of its fellow worker or society or client or whatever the boss, whatever. So effective communication. Then the engineering and society demonstrate understanding of social health. They should know, do not know the what is the health issue on like this. They should able to sensitize. But suppose I am a chemical engineer, when I design a chemical and plant, I should able to say what are the societal effect of the plant if I design in this area. So that skill. Safety, legal and cultural issue. If a student, engineering student, forgot to switch off the power supply after the experiment, then he does not know engineering society practices. Because he forgot to safety issue of the lab. So all small things, which are very important for societal health, safety and legal and cultural issues, are very much important. Next, ethics. Ethics is not that they should know what are the fundamental ethics of India, what are the fundamental ethics of America. They should know or not all those things. Engineering ethics, professional ethics. After the experiment, they should be able to tell the truth to the teacher. Most of the teachers said that if I give an assignment for their self-learning ability, most of the students will copy it from each other. That means we are failed to develop engineering ethics among the students. So ethics, can I develop ethics by a course or can I develop ethics by a practice? As a teacher, I have to think. Environment and sustainability, project management and finance, then lifelong learning. So 1 to 5 is called domain dependent attribute or domain dependent skill set. 6 to 12 are called domain independent skill set or soft skill. The challenge of the teacher is that, should I offer different courses to develop the entire soft skill? Should I offer a course to develop the ethics? Should I offer a course for even English for communication? They say, as an engineering teacher, when I developing domain dependent skill set, suppose I am taking a course on electrical machine. So I am teaching, I am developing the skill of design of AC machine. While I am teaching design of AC machine, can I say that because of my teaching learning process, some of the domain dependent attribute also develop? Their communication skill, their teamwork, their lifelong learning, their ethics, all are developed. So it is a challenge to the teacher, while you are developing any domain dependent skill, you have to develop the domain independent skill also. Offering a single course on English for communication, in my opinion, cannot develop their English communication ability. So what I require, I have to offer a course. I have to take care about the domain independent development while I'm teaching domain dependent skill set. Now, so I just stop here, because if I discuss it, it will go for a long time. So this is a two requirement. In first slide, I have raised few questions for the teacher. In the second part, I have raised the requirement to measure the quality of the program. If I able to measure the quality of the program, and if I able to solve the first slide lecture, first slide problem, then I should able to create an engineer who will comply with accreditation. That's why accreditation never said that it will improve the quality of the graduate engineer. It always said it will guarantee the minimum quality required for a graduate engineer. So you can say that industry will not able to say the engineer produced by the college are not employable or they do not know anything, because they have developed their skill. Our program is objectively measure it quality. So now question is, how do I implement accreditation in the classroom? Unless I implement it, who will design? Student will design, not teacher will design. I may say that I will design an aeroplane in my class, but if a student is not acquired that design principle, so how do I claim that I have taught design in my class? So I have to implement NBA. The NBA is not required by the government of India or anybody. NBA is required by the students. Students should acquire the skill which is required that they should able as a eligible as an engineering graduate. So how do I implement accreditation in the classroom? How do I improve the student engagement? How do I develop their skill? How do I continuously improve? All those things is the question. One of the method to implement accreditation in the classroom is called outcome-based learning. Outcome-based learning. What is outcome-based learning? Is it different from present learning system? Not at all. What is outcome-based learning? If I give you the philosophy of this book, I think many of you have read this book, I think so. So if you read this book, and I think most of you have read this book, no? Can I ask you what is the philosophy of this picture? The philosophy of this picture. Philosophy of the picture is that a girl standing on a junction of path, and he asks the cat which path she should take. Cat replies, where do you want to go? Girl said, I do not know. Then cat replied, take any path, doesn't matter. So unless you know your destination, how do you define the path? Suppose, take about the analog electronics. You said that you have to read analog electronics, those are the topic. How much skill on analog electronics is required for complete as a BTech engineer? So unless I have that target, how do I acquire the skill on analog electronics? So unless you define the target, whether it is blended learning, whether it is flipped teaching, doesn't matter. So outcome-based education said that you define your target. Example, suppose you are admitted in a driving school. What is the outcome of the driving school? You are able to define posturing, you are able to define gear shift, you are able to define all those things, automatic drive, manual drive, all those things. Or you should be able to drive a car on the road. So purpose of the training is to, I should be able to drive a car on the road. Not that I should define what is posturing, what is normal steering, not like that. So outcome says that, can you define what is the end? What is the end? Whatever the subject you take, can you define this is the skill required by you? This is the skill you have to acquire. So that is outcome-based learning. So in the outcome-based learning, what is the role of the teacher? Role of the teacher is define the target. What to achieve? Who will achieve? Students, not teacher. So role of the teacher is mentor and guide the students to reach the target. Think about Arjuna, learning of Arjuna. Dronacharya is only a guide. Target is fixed by the Dronacharya. You have to achieve this target. Depending on your practice, you will be reached there. Not all others are reached there. So as a teacher, I am there to guide you, and this is your target. As a teacher, I am mentor you, I have motivated you to reach the target. So role of the teacher is mentor and guide the student to reach the target and define the target. Why teacher has to define the target? Think about general things. Suppose you have a throat infection. You know, if I take azithromycin, infection will cure. Then also you go to the doctors. A student can search in the internet, analog electronics for BTech engineer. He will get thousands of pages. As a your college, your department, how much analog electronics is required has to be defined by the teachers only. I have a throat infection. I know azithromycin is the solution of the throat infection. I know twice a daily. Then also I have to go to the doctor. Because doctor can only prescribe, depending on the level of the infection, what is the dose of the azithromycin. Similarly, only teacher can provide how much analog electronics is sufficient, how much analog electronics skill, or which of the analog electronics skill is sufficient for a BTech program on my college. That's why teacher has to write the goal. How to write the goal? There is a theory. What is the goal is called? Goal is called outcome, which is called course outcome. So in an outcome-based learning, learning is learner responsibility, not teacher responsibility. It is not what teacher deliver. It is what student has to acquire. So outcome-based learning, teacher is there as a mentor and guide. Teacher will not achieve, student will achieve the goal. So before students come to your class, they should know what are the goal. So as a teacher, I have to define the goal before students is come to my class. Understand? Many of the teachers said, sir, I have this very good, but nobody will come to my class. What is the problem? Problem is that it is, you cannot say that the only student problem. It is problem of the teacher also. Think about our ancient guru. There may be a guru who has a thousands of disciples. There may be a guru only a single disciple. What is the problem? Problem is the motivation. If a guru is enough motivated the people, lot of people will come to the guru. If the guru is not able to motivate the disciple, disciple will not come. So one of the biggest role of the teacher is to motivate the students. Another philosophy is there. Think that, teacher, I cannot say I will teach you. It is a very impossible task. I only say I can guide and mentor you, motivate you to reach the goal. It is matches with our ancient definition of the guru. None of the our guru said that I will take you to the God. Is any guru said that? Nobody said that. Everybody said that I will show you the path to reach the God. So as a teacher, I cannot say I'll teach you. I only say I can guide and mentor you to acquire this skill. There is a difference between outcome-based learning and normal teaching. Okay? So I'm not going details on philosophy of outcome-based learning. So in outcome-based learning, role of the teacher has two roles. Define the target and provide the path. So as a teacher, I have to define the target and I have to provide the path to reach the target. Path may be different. So there may be variety paths to reach the same target. Here I am including the student individuality. Some student can reach the target very quickly on a different path. So as a teacher, I should open to all paths, but target is fixed. So when you say that, that is called outcome-based learning. When you design your target, called outcome-based curriculum development. If you are able to develop your curriculum in outcome-based manner, your accreditation is guaranteed. Your accreditation is guaranteed because outcome-based curriculum will follow the same principle which is required by the accreditation. How it is so? I'll show you. So there is this picture, I think all of you know the 21st century program structure, mission, vision, program, educational outcome, PO, course outcome, then teaching learning process, all those are important. So I'll just briefly define mission, vision and those things and then I go to the course design part. Okay. And then course is defined using course outcome, course overview. This I'll demonstrate you a software where this structure is there. And I'll show you how this can be used for teaching. So mission, vision, I'm not, I think all of you know, but unfortunate part is that most of the MBA document mission, visions are same. Your mission, and that all are all the same, just a minute. I can call you later. So all are same. So what is mission and vision? Vision is a futuristic statement that institute or department like to achieve over a long period of time. I have given an example. Mission is to achieve the vision. So if you see the example, I said I have a computer science department. I said create industry-ready graduate engineer for the present need of software industry. This is my vision. I never said I will create a oil human being, oil researcher, oil educated person. No. I said I will create an industry-ready graduate engineer for a present need of software industry. Because I am writing the vision for my computer science department. If I am writing the vision for my whole institute, so instead of software industry, I may say chemical, local chemical industry, electrical distribution. So I'll put those things. Then I write, how do I achieve this? Offer a well-balanced curricula, instruction and practical experience to the produce skilled graduate with leadership and managerial quality for modern software industry. Then what is their program educational objective? PEO. What is PEO? PEO is a broad, you can say, when you suppose you want to design a product, So your output is a product. Every program output is a product. Now you want to define a tag on the product. This product will use for this purpose. Same thing as a PO also. So I am designing a PO for BTech computer science engineer. So I said that our graduate will able to do this thing. So those is called PO. So how do you write down the PO? Before you write your PO, you have to collect some information. Different professional body, industry, alumni, management, and data on trends in development in the profession. What are the professional body? There are different professional body. Suppose I'm writing a PO of computer science program. So different professional bodies are there. They will survey that, okay, this kind of skill are today required very much. Industry said, those are finer details of the skill. Today we have this kind of AI and data science program and data science, this kind of jobs are there. They should be able to simulate using this kind of software. So those feedback will come from the industry. Alumni will give you feedback that, sir, we have not covered this software by when you join the industry. We have to use those things. So those are very important things. Get a feedback from alumni. Management, all the information when you compile, management may say, those are impossible to implement in the department. So management will define the limitation of the implementation of the required skill. Then, as a department, you write your PO. Suppose I said the consideration, all the data I have analyzed and considering the management limitation, then I put, this is the consideration for writing PO. Most of the students are employed in software industry. So it is not that, suppose you have 80 students in my class. One student may got a higher study in America, but it is not your objective to produce a research engineer. If your 30% student is taking higher study, then you can say, one of my PO should contain the higher study things. But if my 80% students are employed in a software industry, then I have to write this only. So depending on the data, I can write PO. Then I can design consistency between PO and mission. So this is my mission, and this is my key component of the mission statement. And I can say which PO is matching with key component of the mission statement. That is called consistency between PO and mission. Then program outcome. Program outcome you cannot change. Program outcomes are the 12 graduate attribute. So 1 to 5 is called domain dependent, and 6 to 12 is called domain independent program outcome. So when a PO is acquired for electronics engineering, then it's become PSO. Program specific outcome. Along with the rider, the PSO is also include one or two more specific department specific outcome. What is department specific outcome? Suppose Institute A has an electronics department, electronics BTech electronics program. Institute B also has a BTech electronics program. How they differ? Institute A may say, I am very good in microwave engineering. Institute B may say, I am very good in embedded system. So in this 12 PO and one or two PO, more one to 12 is PO, one to five is domain specific. So one to five is also PSO, and you can write one or two PSO to describe your strength of the program. So PSO, which is domain, which is department specific or which is institute specific, you can write at the end of the 12 PO that my electronics program is emphasized on VLSI design. So they should able to simulate VHDL code for this purpose. So that is your emphasized person. So PSO consists of two things. 5 PO including department specific outcome, that is called PSO. Or you can write down your department specific outcome in 1 to 5 PO manner. So 1 to 5, solution ability, analyzing ability, design ability, testing ability, tools use ability, you can write towards micro M, then that also a PSO. Okay, but I prefer write your 1 or 2 PSO separately, which is related to the strength of your program, and add to the after 12 PSO 1 and PSO 2 you can write down. But 1 to 5 is also PSO. Okay, now I come to the instructional, or I can say the you can say that objective, course objective, what is course objective, all kind of things are there, no? So now come to here. In NBA document, you have seen there is a learning objective and learning outcome. This is a confusing statement to many of you. Learning goal and objective is not learning outcome. Learning outcome is called instructional objective. Learning goal or objective sometimes describe what the instructor or programs aim to do. But that is not my importance. My importance is what student has to acquire. So that is called learning outcome. So I have never said to the learning objective. So in my case, objective means instructional objective. So I am not favored to this one. This one, in my opinion, is not required. Because what you want to do, you say the students, doesn't matter. What students acquire is important. What student has to be acquired, that is important. So whenever I refer to the objective, this objective means outcome, which is called instructional objective. What is instructional objective? A statement describes in observable and measurable terms what a learner is able to do after completing the instruction or course. So I can say an instructional objective can be defined a statement of something which is specific, measurable, achievable, that a student is able to do after receiving the instruction. Okay, any instructional objective has a 3 component. So this is a part of ISD principle. I'm not going into details on the ISD principle. Performance component, condition component, criteria component, all theory are there in my another course which is available in YouTube, accreditation and outcome based learning. You can read it for details on it. So it is detailed explained what is taxonomy of learning, what is performance component, condition component, all are explained. I'm not going to explain all those things. So as a teacher, when you design a course, how do you design an outcome based curricula, or how do you write the, your course outcome is important. Instead of giving a lecture presentation, I'll show you in a software by which you can design your own curricula for outcome based learning, and I'll show you how you can use it for your teaching purpose to answer the slide questions, question raised in the slide number 1. And tomorrow, I think today time will be not there, tomorrow I'll show you POCO mapping and attainment of the course goal. I'll describe it tomorrow. So today I'll show you the demonstrate the software so that you can use it for designing your own course, and I'll explain how this can be used for your teaching purpose to improve the teaching. Forget about the accreditation, or how this can be used to implement accreditation in the classroom. So the software address is www.ide.iitkgp.ac.in. If you are able to see it in the address bar, it is there. If you click it, it will open this one. Then once you open it, go to the course institute registration. So if you click on institute registration, it will open the institute registration page. Here, register your institute. Your institute can register here. Why institute registration is there? Because as a institute, suppose your institute has a 10 program, 10 program has different course. So you can organizedly develop the whole institute curricula in an outcome-based manner. That's why the institute registration is there. So suppose I am writing FDP, this is FDP program for Jodhpur.
Yes, sir.
You can do it as a one of your institute, you define your institute coordinator, one person can do it, whatever I am doing, as a proper name of your institute, okay? So that this is a test purpose, I am doing it, okay? Suppose I said...
Sir, the screen is not visible actually, only we are able to see the PPT.
Oh, sorry, just a minute. I have to change the sharing.
Yeah. Yes, participants are also asking for the name of the website.
I'll show you, just a minute. I just share the screen first.
Yes.
I thought that it is invisible.
Actually, yes. Participants can post their queries into the chat box.
Now can you see it?
Yes.
It is visible?
Yeah.
So the address is www.id.itkgp.ac.in. Okay, so this highlighted portion. Now, any institute can register in this site by putting that institute name. Let's I put a temporary institute name FDP Jodhpur as an institute. Then as an institute representative, you can put an institute representative email ID. Let's I put an email ID as I am an institute representative. Oh, sorry, it is a name. So name means email ID is here and name is SDM. Okay, now password. So why it is institute registration is required? Because suppose this software is free and can be used by anybody. So from your institute, there may be a Jodhpur Engineering College, 10, 12 times Jodhpur Engineering College is required. So that will be confusing where you have developed. So instead of doing that, from one of the member of your college can act as an institute representative and register your institute by providing a password and email ID, and then you can write down your institute mission, vision and home address and submit. So see that your institute is successfully registered. Now I search for, there are a lot of institutes there, so I can search for it. So control F, FDP Jodhpur, JUB. Jodhpur is come, so I click there. So as an institute representative, I know my password. Now I can add program. So suppose your institute has a CSE program. CSE, BTEC CSE, you can write down BTEC CSE. They write down program educational objective. Then provide your institute representative password, which you created during the institute registration. Okay, so program is successfully created. So now BTEC program is now created. Now under the BTEC program, there will be many courses. BTEC computer science has many courses. So register your courses. Now you say all computer science faculty should register the courses under the BTEC courses. Institute is Jodhpur, course is BTEC CSE. And under that, they can register their courses. So suppose I have a course on acoustics. Let's example. Okay. And principal developer, let's, I put SDM. I put email ID. test.gmail. Let's I put the password. So I have to remember the password. Unless your course is fully developed, it will be not visible to anybody. It will be password protected, only visible to you only. Okay, so I put the password 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and I put the contact number. It is not necessary whether the course subject or elective, UG, PG, which semester I taught it, then I submit. So your course is registered successfully. So my course is registered as an acoustics. So I go to acoustics and go to course development page. So what is my course is password protected. So I given test.gmail and I give the password. I log into the course. Okay. Now, so under the institute, I am developing one course. Similarly, another person is developing another course. So all courses are developing together. So an institute coordinator can view all courses, but not the content, only which courses, how much development is done. That can institute coordinator monitor. Now, once I go to the course development process as a teacher, my role is to develop the entire course. What course content? So course is content, course overview, course objective means instructional objective. That is nothing but an outcome. Then course module and course problem. I'll describe one by one. What is course overview? What should be the course overview? As a teacher, can you write one line? What is course overview? So course overview, most of you can think it is the coverage of the courses. I said it is two things. One paragraph, how do you motivate the student about this course? And one paragraph about the coverage of the course. Have you understand? How do you, because you are preparing a e-learning document. I can say you how this can be used in during this kind of online teaching also in COVID situation. So you develop your course overview, then develop your course objective, means outcome. This objective is nothing but an instructional objective where Bloom's taxonomy is embedded. So you do not know taxonomy of learning, but taxonomy is embedded. So what is course outcome or course objective means instructional objective. What is course outcome? Course outcome is nothing but a major takeaway from the course by the students. So how many course outcome I can write? How many course outcome? A course is generally 40 hours, 40 lecture course or 40 contact hour course in case of BTEC. So if it is 40 contact hour, how many major skill you can develop? 5 to 6? Average 5 to 6 lecture required for one skill. Then if I write 5 outcome, that means average length of the each outcome to acquire is 8 lecture. If it is 6, then is some outcome can be acquired 6 lecture, some can 10, some can take 12. So that way I can write at most 6 outcome. So course outcome are the major takeaway by the students. It is not that you have to write, describe, comprehension level, application level. It is not that. Don't think about it. Only think about what are the major takeaway by the students of your course. Let's see. I have a course on acoustics. I'll show you. Visible? PPT is visible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So if you see, my acoustic course has 3 outcomes. Given the specification of that acoustic room, determine this parameter. Given the specification of an auditorium, determine the acoustic requirement, list the acoustical requirement, and design the acoustic part of the auditorium. Suppose this is my one of the course outcome, I write it here. Now, if you know the Bloom's taxonomy, what is the action verbs of the Bloom's taxonomy called? Every English verbs is not action verbs. The verbs which are measurable is called action verbs. So if you see, this is the list of verbs which are measurable is action verbs. Now suppose I do not know Bloom's taxonomy. So here there are the two verbs, list and design. So I do not know what is the cognitive level of the list. So I go for list L. List. What is the cognitive level? Knowledge, which is the primary level of a Bloom's taxonomy. Where the PO level start? From application, analysis, synthesis, evaluation for BTEC program. So my course outcome must be application, analysis, and synthesis and evaluation level. I cannot write knowledge level course outcome. So let's, another verb is there, design. So again, I go for that and I press D. So D, then I go for design. Which level? Synthesis level, which is matches with my PO. So I, this is my correct course outcome. So when you write a course outcome, it is not a single line statement. It may be a paragraph, but it should be specific, measurable, and achievable. A course outcome may contain more than one action verbs, doesn't matter. But the action verbs which is associated with the highest cognitive level is the cognitive level of your outcome. So since it has a design and knowledge both, but design is the highest cognitive level, that's why it is synthesis is the cognitive level of this outcome. So this way I can write down the course outcome, 5 to 6 course outcome, which is called course objective or instructional objective. Then a course is divided into several modules. So I can say the module means chapter, or in your term is called unit. In our term, it is totally different. We said module and unit. Unit means lecture. So let's say first chapter is chapter 1. I can put the chapter name. When I add, the chapter will be added. Then for every chapter, I have to write down the chapter overview. I have to write down the chapter outcome. Chapter outcome is different from course outcome. Course outcome are the holistic outcome which is major takeaway by the course. But the chapter outcome are the within that chapter what student has to achieve. That is called chapter outcome. But the procedure of writing is same. Okay? And what is else is chapter unit. Chapter unit means lecture. So a chapter consists of a suppose 5 lecture. So I have a lecture 1. I add it. So lecture 1 is added. So for every lecture, 1 hour lecture, I have a lecture summary. I have to write down the lecture summary. For every lecture, I have a lecture summary, lecture outcome. And lecture outcome and lecture level problem. What is lecture level problem? When you write an any outcome, whether it is course level, module level, or lecture level, that must have associated with a problem. I'll show you in course level problem. So course level, I have already written now outcome, so outcome is visible here. So I said, this is the problem which is catered to this outcome. So that way, you have to design the entire course. Once your entire course is available, how you use it for teaching, let's come in here. Suppose this is a course which is completely developed, but I'm not guaranteed that all outcomes are correct. All outcome is not correct also this course. So this is course overview. Once your course is completed and published, anybody can open your course and see this structure. Course overview, course outcome, and course test item. So course overview, this person doesn't written down that motivation part, only write down the coverage part. Then this is the outcome. And this is the course level problem. So in the course level problem, if a student is able to solve this problem, that means he or she achieved this outcome. A student is able to solve this problem, he or she achieved this outcome. So for every outcome, at least one problem has to be developed by the teachers. Then a module. Every module has module outcome, module test item. And for every module, there will be a module learning strategy. Means you have to say If you want to learn this chapter, read this book, this chapter, this page to this page. Read this paper, this page to this page. Read this animation, read this website, read this NPTEL video. Do not say to the student, read this NPTEL video. Say, read this chapter of this NPTEL video, this lecture of this NPTEL video, or this lecture this time to this time. So that is the job of the teacher, to provide the path to the student. How do you use it for your teaching? I'm exceeding my time. So another 5 minutes. So suppose you have developed the entire content. All of you have learned about the blended learning, flipped teaching. What is flipped teaching? Unless this structure is available, what do you flip? Now what you say, this is available, accessible by every student. Now you ask to the students that tomorrow I'll take a lecture on lecture number one. So every student know what is the lecture summary, what is the lecture outcome, and what kind of problem they have to solve after this lecture. And you instructed the students, tomorrow I'll take this lecture one. All have to come prepared in my class. Then in your class, what do you do? Instead of delivering information in the class, which is already given to the students, you write a problem related to the concept of the class and ask the student to solve that problem. If many students is able to solve the problem, that means they have studied it before coming to the class. If the concept is very difficult, they're not able to understand, then take 20 minutes to describe the concept only. Again, ask the student to solve the problem. Ask any student to present in the board. So what you are actually doing? You are actually encouraging self-learning. You are encouraging communication skill. You are encouraging lifelong learning. You are encouraging of the student engagement, because now student cannot say, I do not know what will cover in the next lecture. Because every lecture is precisely defined. The student precisely read it before they come to the class. They have a different problem they can solve it in the home. So engagement of the student is increased. Self-learning ability, they will try to solve the problem which is already given in here. That means I'm providing assignment. Then there is self-learning, and then communication skill. That means I'm developing soft skill. So this is called flipped teaching or blended learning, whatever you say. Then once this is developed, suppose you have written down this outcome, or let's course level I go. So you have written down, this is your course outcome. Suppose the course is data structure and algorithm. Somebody sitting in the industry can say, this kind of skill do not require today. Instead of this, you can teach this, or you can develop this kind of skill among the students. So as a teacher, I'm getting direct feedback from the industry, what is required, what not to be required, what not to be taught. Anybody sitting in the industry anytime can add a test item. They can go, they can write their email ID name. So they can say, sir, this is the good problem to solve for this course. So they can upload, or they can say that for this outcome, this is the good problem. They can submit. So that problem will come to you. So this is called continuous improvement of the curricula or industry academia collaboration. I will not prolong it, because if I prolong it, then I do not have a time to interact with you, because I can at least 6 minutes I want to interact with you. So today I'll stop here. Tomorrow I'll start from here only. So my home task to all of you is that, can you develop your course outcome registering the course on this software? I'll recommend at least Jodhpur Engineering College, you create your institute registration and include the department, the teachers are there, and ask the teacher to develop their at least course outcome in this topic.
Sure, sir, sure. We'll do.
Now, how this can be used in this kind of COVID situation teaching? So all of you know that now this is a learning, online learning. People are saying online learning. They may somebody use my team, Google Meet, Microsoft Team. Are you think that online learning is possible if the all the students are they're distributed in different geographical area? Somebody may not have a connectivity, somebody may not have an internet problem, all kinds of problems are there. So can you develop this entire course and give it to the student before they join your live interaction? So instead of delivering information in live interaction, you just interact with the students.
Yes, sir.
It may be a phone, it may be a chat, it may be a video, doesn't matter.
Yes, sir.
So instead of delivering information, if you deliver, none of the students will listen to you. They will just log in and either sleep or they will do something else and their computer will remain on.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So tomorrow I'll start tomorrow. So today, sure. I quickly one or two questions I can answer.
Sir, I am having one question, sir.
Yes.
Sir, you said that learning is the responsibility of learner.
Yes.
And the role of teacher is to define the target and guide the path. It is more of mentoring type. So yes. The question is how to decide the or how to identify the effectiveness of a teacher, because many of the participants are principal and at the key positions in the different institution. So they used to have this kind of task that they need to measure the effectiveness of different teachers. So how
that is different. So there is another lecture of mine. It is not included here. That is, yes, called attributes of good teaching.
Yes, yes. Sir.
How do you measure the good teacher? So there, yes, is a lot of research. There is a lot of research. There are a lot of parameter, a lot of procedure to measure the good teaching capability. Means, yes, a teacher is not good if it's there is some teaching evaluation, teaching feedback, no? But the purpose, yes, of this, it is not to define who is a good teacher, who is a bad teacher. It is purpose to how can I improve my teaching quality.
Yes.
So there is a lot of lectures are there. If yes, tomorrow I get a time, I can cover 10 minutes on that. Unless you can listen that lecture in YouTube, that attributes of good teaching. The subject is attributes of good teaching. Now, teacher effectiveness, if I say, teacher effectiveness is not to deliver the information. Teacher effectiveness comes from the students. Are the students learn? Whether you deliver a one-hour lecture in the class or you spend that 1 hour with interaction with the student, doesn't matter. At the end, student has to develop the skill. You will not give the exam. Student will give the exam. Student will present to the society. So unless they acquire the skill, how good you deliver doesn't matter. Anybody else?
Any other question from the participants? I think participants can write their questions and write in the chat box, or you can keep it for the tomorrow session also. Sir would be with us in tomorrow session also. So
yes, PPT will be available. I can share the PPT.
yes. So you can think of what the things are told to you during this. I think this is the best what we can expect in this session, because we started with the NBA accreditation is not the formality or the paper formality. It is how it can be benefited, or it is for students basically. It is not for teachers or it is not for institutions. It is for students, how students can be benefited out of this. So you totally emphasized on this part, and I think this would be clearing many doubts in the minds of teachers, and they would be having correct vision at least of the NBA that it is to improve the effectiveness of the teaching, teaching learning process, not to put as a burden that, okay, NBA accreditation is a burden on our shoulder and we need to get through this. So I think I cannot expect a session better than this. And I have been listening to you, sir, through your MOOCs also. So again, I am spellbound and I am very much impressed by the delivery or the inspiration which you impart during your session. So thank you, sir, for sparing your valuable time with us, and we'll be with you again in the
tomorrow morning.
Yeah,
so,
yeah, sure.
Tomorrow 11:30. Okay.
Yeah, sure. Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.